We are here with David Hamilton again at Mind, Body and Spirit in London on the 11th of the 11th of the 11th. This auspicious day just helps us to really connect and center. And I think that that's what the day is. What does it mean for you?
Actually, very like that. It's a day of, I think, understand. For me, it's a day of recognizing that we're all part of the same family.
Yeah.
We're all part of the same source, you know, not in a, I don't mean that in a religious sense, but the same, we're all together in
this
world.
We're all made of the same
stuff. Yeah, we're all made of the same stuff, and we're, this is about, you know, peace and compassion and that kind of, so for me, that's what personally resonates with me about that, this auspicious day.
Yeah, and the auspicious day sort of just really gives you a day that has a very sacred number to remember that.
Absolutely. It sticks in your mind because of the significance of 11-11-11. It's like a New Year's Day kind of thing.
And there's so much, I mean, there's world, there's global celebration. Mm. As we speak, people around the world are going crazy about this day. So it does feel, you can almost feel the, not just the energy here, but the universal energy. You've just finished a gorgeous workshop.
Yeah.
How was that?
It was fantastic. I really enjoyed that. I got to have a play, really. A play in the sense that I got to talk on a subject that I don't often talk on.
Yeah.
You know, very well known for the mainstream science of the mind-body connection, that type of stuff. So I got to play a bit with the ideas of what consciousness is and how consciousness, the mind, might actually have a shape, some hand in shaping patterns in your life.
And what is that?
That, you know, for example, if you have a hope or a dream in your life, then how that hope or a dream itself might actually be forming a pattern in reality, somehow having an impact on the wider world, so that what you hold to be, you hold in your mind as something you'd love to have and experience in your life, it might actually impact, at least influence the likelihood of that occurring if you keep imagining it as true and keep, you know, wishing for it, so to speak.
Yes. So I guess the power of thought comes into play.
Yeah.
And David is a scientist, so he has, your mind works in a scientific way. And I love that because the law of attraction is science. And so the things that we create in our minds, the pictures in this virtual reality, are really manifesting. And I think with more, tell me the story about the magnifying glass. You know, when you try to start a fire, if you hold the magnifying glass there for a short while, nothing will happen. But if you keep it there and you keep it there and the sun shining through it, you will start a fire. And that's the thought. The more you think of something, the more you see the pictures in your mind, the more likely they are to manifest.
And all I've been trying to do in this subject area is see if I could find a scientific framework or a scientific explanation that would at least some way go some length towards explaining why this phenomenon occurs, that what you picture in your mind seems to influence the circumstances of your life. And you know, I think it happens in many different ways. Sometimes, I mean, the obvious way that you actually go do something about it, you take an action, but on even on more subtle levels, like sometimes weird stuff just happens synchronistically. And what I've been trying to do is find some science out there that might explain why that occurs. And it seems to all converge on this idea that we're all, that our consciousness is actually interconnected at a very, very deep level. And that doesn't always fit with the standard models of the world of neuroscience that says consciousness is a side effect of chemistry in the brain. But what it's actually saying is another model that people are saying is that's correct, but in a, you know, consciousness as we know it is a side effect of chemistry in the brain, but it's not the full story. That maybe at a deeper level, there is another aspect of our consciousness that's actually stitched into the fabric of reality itself. And only from that understanding can we then get the idea that we could impact circumstances of life. And if consciousness is stitched into the fabric of reality and into time and space at the very, very core level of reality, just like you can stretch a fabric, then in a sense, as you move up to life, macroscopic reality, as we call it, as separate from quantum reality, which is very small, macroscopic is a very big, then just like you can throw a stone across the room, if consciousness is knitted into the fabric of reality, you should be able to throw your consciousness across the room and impact things at a distance. You should also be able to sense the future, etc. And that's what I've been trying to find and understand, a scientific framework.
As you're speaking, I'm thinking qualities of like superheroes. And like, you know, really, those are like qualities you see in like a cartoon, but actually, where do they come from? I mean, really the ability to think things into being and into reality is so real and so true, and yet we don't really absorb this. We don't believe this to the core of our being, and I think that might be where the learning is, what we really have to absorb. But your new book, the
Contagious Power of Thinking. That was something I really enjoyed writing, because what I did with that book is I set out to try to explain that a small group of people with compassion and kindness in their hearts could actually change the world. And that's what I was really trying to find, I've always believed that kindness can make the world a better place.
Yeah.
So what if I could find evidence for a ripple effect? You know, you drop a pebble in a pond, it creates ripples.
Yes.
Could I find evidence for a ripple effect of kindness? And so I started out looking into that. And eventually what I found was all this information, all this research that had been done that shows that actually emotions themselves transmit from person to person. So if you're feeling happy, your happiness actually impacts on the other person's brain through a circuit in the brain called your mirror neuron system. And your emotions actually show up in other people's minds and in their bodies. And what you find is you catch people's emotions. And we live in such an interconnected world that Harvard University took a social network of 12,000 people with, you know, a few hundred thousand social connections between them. And they found that happiness caused a ripple effect, so did depression. Happiness, for example, rippled out to three social steps, you know, to your friend. So you're feeling happy, you affect your friends' friends, and your friends' friends' friends. Right? So your emotions are transmitting all the time.
So we can create a happy revolution. We can create a happy revolution.
By feeling happy ourselves, we're affecting people out to three social steps, or what it's called, 3 degrees of separation.
It almost feels, you know, when you say, as you're speaking, I'm thinking, isn't it our duty to be happy? And if you're not happy, make yourself happy, because it really is. You go out into the world, and that's the energy you give the world.
Yeah.
And it sort of vibrates into the world, so that's what you're passing along.
And there's a lot of people who can do that very consciously, make themselves happy. And some people are in much more difficult spaces where it's not possible. But then it's our duty then to show compassion and to help them. Because what these social network studies show is the mental health of people, even people you think is remote, they don't have many friends or contacts and they're feeling very depressed. Actually, even if you feel insulated by several groups of friends, because we live in such an interconnected world, their mental health is affecting your mental health and vice versa. And the most compassionate thing we can do is to help each other. And the side effect of it is, if we help people who are not able to get themselves happier because it's not as easy for them because of their life situations, if we help these people, then it has a knock-on effect in the entire social network, and everyone gains, including you. It's like you get back what you give out. You give compassion out, and you become more elevated and happier yourself. You're not trying to be happy by doing it, but just by being kind and compassionate, the side effect of it improves your happiness.
It really does.
But so does it improve everyone, because we live in these interconnected social networks, it affects everyone.
You know, don't you find that if you're feeling a bit down and then somebody calls you and they're feeling down and you feel like you have to bring it to make them happy, and you do, and you're like, come on, get up, you can do it. Suddenly you've brought yourself up.
Yeah.
And they're up too, and you're like, wow, we're all happy.
Yeah.
It's totally amazing. And for the woman who is, you know, mom and kids and really busy and stressful, how can this work in their lives? What can they do to embody some of this?
If they can, hang around with people who are happy. You know, not always as easy done as that, but if we can find people who are happy or happier or more positive, it actually benefits us to spend time with them and find out who we're spending time with who are bringing us down, and spend a little bit less time with them, if that's possible. And I'm not saying all these things are always possible, but for many people these things are possible. The other thing to do is actually do more kindness. Because see, when you make an effort to actually, outside of your normal sense of compassion and kindness, but if you can go that extra half mile, that extra little bit in helping people out, it does actually make you feel happier, and it relaxes your nervous system. So you actually do benefit from looking out for the best for everyone else, providing you're not always looking out for everyone else and neglecting yourself. But if you can take care of yourself as well as helping other people, it does actually have a positive effect on your nervous system, on your heart and everything.
Yeah, that's so, so true. It's such good advice. You know, just first of all, look at who you're spending time with, and just try to choose more positive people and environments to be in. And then, you know, I think ultimately look at yourself and your compassion to the world. Treat the world like you would treat your best friend or your child, and be kind to everybody, because that gets given back to you. You feed it. Life is our mirror. So I think that's great advice. One more question. When you hear mind, body, and spirit, what does that conjure up for you?
Probably different.
Obviously, it's the name of our show. Yeah. Mind, body, and spirit.
Yeah, I think some people, when they think of mind, body, spirit, people in very much mainstream, they consider it as kind of woo-woo stuff and all, and I don't agree with that at all, because we are mind, body, spirit. I'd say, personally, my own view, this is my own scientific view as well, is when you go right down to the fabric of reality, it is all consciousness. I would call that spirit. And I'd say our spirit itself lies within the very fabric of reality. So mind, body, spirit for me actually means we are part of something much grander than ourselves. We're all part of the same thing. We share spirit in a sense, all of us. And you know, your body feels separate, but the deeper you go down into the body, you start finding consciousness, you start finding spirit, and it's like a cone. You think you're all separate out here, but the deeper, the more you look inside, the more you realize there's only one of us in the room. And that's for me what mind, body, spirit means.
Wow, that's a good place to end. David, thank you so much.
You're welcome. My pleasure.